This is a live recording of one of Dr. Taylor Crick's live workshops. This particular one was recorded at Align Family Chiropractic in Salt Lake City, Utah, and covered toxicity and natural ways to detox. And now, Dr. Taylor Crick.
So welcome. Glad to have everybody here. I hope I'm not too much in your laps in the front row here, but I'll try to stay away from you, not spit on you, Chad. So, you know, first off, like I said, thanks for being here. How many people, and also another thing I want to mention is I have a wire here. We're recording this because it's going to go on our podcast channel. So has anybody here checked out our podcast channel? Couple people here and there. It had over 500 listens in the first 2 weeks. I'm still trying to figure out who it was because I know that all 500 could not have been my mom. She's probably some of them, but she could have been all of them. But raise your hands if you're here because you want to learn about how people become toxic. Who's curious to hear that? Okay, now raise your other hand if you want to learn more about how to detox, how you can naturally detox. And raise both hands if you want to learn about both. Okay, good. So that's most of the room. That's everybody in the room. So that's awesome because that's exactly what we're going to cover is not just, you know, how do you become toxic, but then once you are, or how can you know if you are, what you can do to help your body naturally detoxify. And the reason that this is a big concern is we're going to go through it a little bit, but, you know, disease rates today, do you think they're going up or they've been going down lately? They've been going up, right, for decades. And toxins continue to be introduced into our environment, industrial toxins, environmental toxins, toxins in our food supply, even natural toxins that we produce continue to go up and up and up. And as our bodies become more toxic, disease rates go up. And so if you're familiar with our office, you know, what we work with are five key essentials, and minimizing toxicity is essential number five. That's the very last one, right? Because if you're doing all the other four, you know, if you have a perfect spine and you're getting adjusted regularly and you're eating an excellent diet and you exercise daily and you have an excellent mindset, it doesn't matter if you're toxic because toxins can sabotage all the right things that you're doing. So it's an easy thing to make sure that you're not filling your toxic bucket, as we say, and know what you can do to naturally detox. And that is the first thing is, you know, the toxic bucket. So are you a toxic waste bucket? Okay. And the other thing I'll mention too is, you know, I mentioned the podcast. I'm going to be referencing that a couple times because we're only able to scratch the surface with some of these things tonight. We're not going to be able to go into them in too much detail, but we have some podcast episodes that we can point you in the right direction to learn more about what we mean when I say, are you a toxic waste bucket? So we just released one a little over a week ago, and that's what it was called, Are You a Toxic Waste Bucket? And so we have this bucket here, right? So some of you may have seen this throughout the week, or the last couple weeks, but the question is, are you a toxic waste bucket? What do you guys think the answer is? Yeah, yes, we all are, okay? And so that's not an insult, but we are all a toxic waste bucket. And what that means is that when you continue adding things to a bucket, what eventually happens? It raises up and it overflows, right? So if we're continually adding to our toxicity bucket, eventually that bucket can overflow, and that's when symptoms arise. So we are all, yes, a toxic waste bucket. So that's why you talk about, you know, dumping your bucket or filling your bucket. That's what we're going to go into. And on your notes sheet, your handout sheet right there, it says, kind of in the middle or towards the bottom, it says, there's two steps to effectively detoxifying. Stop filling the bucket and then empty the bucket, right? Because if you empty the bucket but you keep filling it up, it's going to overflow again. Or if you don't empty the bucket but you just slow down the flow, it's still going to fill up eventually. So you have to do both to effectively detox. And, you know, here's why this is a concern, is there's more than 80,000 industrial chemicals available in the United States today that have never been tested for their safety and how they interact with each other. There's 15,000 of those chemicals in our food supply. So we're being exposed to it from a lot of different sources, 80,000 different sources. With that, you know, the reason that it's a toxic waste bucket, too, is these toxins, a lot of them tend to accumulate, or what we call bioaccumulate, which means that they stay in your body. They get stored in your body. So this next one, DDT, was found. They did a study, and they tested fat cells because these are fat-soluble. This is a fat-soluble toxin. And they found DDT in every single person's fat cells. And how many people know about DDT or have heard of DDT? Do you know when it was outlawed in the U.S.? I hear the S's, 70s. Yeah, President Nixon is the one that banned it. In 2001, it was banned globally. So that's a long time ago, right? But it's still showing up positive in our fat cells today because these toxins are still around and they accumulate. And it's not just ours either. You know, 2005 study tested umbilical cords of babies. This is kind of disturbing, right? Tested umbilical cords of babies and found an average of 200 industrial chemicals and pollutants in the umbilical cords of babies. So that's why it's scary, because it's not only that we are a toxic waste bucket, but we're passing that along. And what do you think? You know, if we're a bucket, how big's a baby, right? Like a Solo cup? So they fill up really quickly and they overflow really quickly. So we can't be filling them up. So and why should we care? You know, why does this matter? And like we talked about, you know, with the disease rates, like we said, those are going up. They're not going down. And what that looks like today is there's over 20 million Americans now that suffer from autoimmune conditions. That number a few decades was significantly less. That's one of the biggest concerns, health concerns that's on the rise, are autoimmune conditions where your immune system begins to attack your own body. Couple of those others, you know, breast cancer, that's one of the diseases that's expected to rise by at least 50% in the next 15 years from now. By 2030, it's supposed to rise another 50%. Well, when they've tested breast cancer tumors for a specific toxin called parabens, they found it in 99% of the tumors that were tested. And in a majority of the women, they actually found all different five different types of parabens. If you want to know what the all five are, you can just flip around this Cetaphil. It's got almost all of them in it. But they were almost all found in these breast cancer tumors. And I'm not saying that one caused the other. You can't derive causation from that. But you can't deny that there's a correlation, and you can't deny that this is a concern. So what I want everybody to do is turn to the person on your left and then the person on your right and say, this is kind of like an AA meeting or something. Hi, I'm Taylor, and I'm toxic. Okay, so turn and, because the first step is admitting that you have a problem. Okay, so now that that's out in the open, we've aired our dirty laundry. We all know that each other is toxic. We're all starting off on the same levels here. Now, here's another couple things that just continue to increase. Asthma rates have skyrocketed. Allergies as well. 28% in a decade. And now there's over 25 million people suffering from asthma. There's a lot more that continue to rise with allergies too. The two of those tend to rise together. Then here's a scary one for where we live. 1 in 54 children in Utah with autism, right? And that number's getting smaller and smaller. It used to be 120, then it was 88, then it was 65, and now it's 1 in 54, and that number keeps getting smaller and smaller, and that's scary. And, you know, we can't nail down exactly which toxins are causing it. You know, one thing I'm not going to say tonight is I'm definitely not going to say vaccines cause autism, but I definitely think that they play a role, and we're going to go through that. Another thing that plays a role, Harvard came out with a study last summer linking the inversion, you know, the air pollution that we all breathe, linking the states with the worst inversion are also the states with the worst autism rates, and that's why they said that Utah is the worst state in the union when it comes to autism rates. So can we all agree that this is a concern and that our health continues to get worse and worse and worse? We have to start looking outside of the medical system for the solutions and for the causes. Can we all agree with that? That's what we're going to do tonight, is look for what can be causing these things so we can stop filling the bucket up, but also start to dump that bucket out and help your body detoxify in an effective way. So what might happen, you know, if you are toxic? How would you know if you are toxic? Well, you know, a couple of the bigger ones, you know, we talked about several diseases like, you know, cancer. There's a lot of studies linking toxicity to cancer, autoimmunity, you know, some of these bigger diseases. But before you're diagnosed with, a big disease, what are some signs that you might have right now? You know, so some of them are like brain fog or lethargy or low energy. Those are huge ones. And I want you to look at these and think who this sounds like, okay? So obesity, inflammation, poor digestion, fatigue, headache, mood swings, nausea, immune dysfunction, allergies, high blood pressure, hormone imbalance, skin irritation, and poor energy. Who does that sound like to you guys? Everybody, right? Yeah, so are we all toxic? Yes, we all are. And some of us are expressing some of these symptoms more than others. But yeah, it sounds like everybody today. And so when you detox, you know, really everybody will feel better to some degree, depending on how toxic you were to begin with. But here are my toxic top five, because that's what we want to get into first, is how we can stop filling the bucket. Because if this is your bucket, and you just keep throwing stuff in it and not caring about what you're throwing in, eventually you're going to run out of room for other things, right? So number one up there, medications. Okay, we're going to go through each of these in detail. But medications are inherently toxic. And I'm not saying go out right now and when you get home, throw your medications away. I can't legally say that. Get off them with the help of your doctor. But if you're on one, you know, the important thing to do is continue looking for what's causing it. Because would you agree that a person that doesn't need any medications is probably healthier than a person who does need medications? Because they don't need them. They don't have the symptoms. They don't have the problems. So continue looking for the cause. And we're going to go into this in detail. But then tap water. This isn't tap water, but you know, pour that in. We're going to talk about how that can be dangerous. Now, one of the things with essential number five, our fifth essential, the way that that's worded is it says minimize your exposures to toxins, right? Because we're not going to eliminate them. We don't sell plastic bubbles. You can't ever eliminate all your toxins, but you minimize your exposures. So tap water is a big one because we're just exposed to it so often. The next one, household products. So then we start throwing in some things like our air fresheners, our Cetaphil, lotions, deodorants, Aquanet, you know, household products. We're going to go through those in detail. Fourth one is heavy metals. This is a really important one because it can really devastate your overall health. And this one, you know, it gets into a little bit more intense versions of detox, and you have to be a little bit more specific with testing and things like that to know whether or not you have heavy metal toxicity. But this is a huge one. And I'll even show you that, you know, sometimes heavy metal toxicity might be the thing that you're exposed to the most often, even more so than tap water or more so than, you know, inversion or dirty air, because there's things that are in your body that are providing these heavy metals at all times. Then the last one is food additives. So, you know, I already tossed in the Pop-Tarts and the Monster energy drink. So the food additives, you have to know where those are coming from so that you can properly avoid them. But those are the toxic top five that we're going to go through, and go through each one of these in detail. So the first one, medications. Okay, so the medications are inherently toxic. Your body has to detoxify every medication, even if it's life-saving. If it's life-saving and you need to be on it, your body still has to detoxify it. So here's a list, and just to prove this to you, because I'm not going to show you, you know, everything about each and every medication, but just take a look at this list. And as I'm reading these, think about people that you know. You may be on one of these personally. One of the scary things about this list is, on this list, I've been on one, my wife's been on one, my mom's been on another one. Okay, so and these are all the medications that have class action lawsuits against them. So Abilify, that is a antidepressant. Accutane, that is an acne medication. That's one that I was on. Test heavy for heavy metals when you've been on this. Now you can see commercials that class action lawsuit that it causes Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. It eats your digestive system from the inside out. Not good. Avandia, that was a huge one a few years back. That was a diabetes medication that was a big scandal that they hid the research. And people found out that it was really harming people. So that's one that you've seen maybe in the news a lot, the Avandia. Crestor, that is a statin. That's a cholesterol-lowering medication. Cymbalta, that's another mental one, depression. Depakote, that is typically for seizures, things. Effexor, Fosamax, Lexapro, Lipitor, Mirena. So, you know, a couple of these. Fosamax, does anybody know what that's for? Bone density, yeah, so bone density. And there are natural ways that you can increase your bone density, and actually relatively easily. Lipitor, that's another statin, just like Crestor, anything with the ORs or statins. Mirena, this is a big one. That is an intrauterine device, a birth control device. And we've had some patients that they've had some weird symptoms. And we say, hey, you know, maybe you should take a look at this. you know, you have this device in you that's putting artificial hormones in, maybe you should take a look at it, talk to your doctor and see what you can do. They've gotten it removed and their weird symptoms went away literally that day. And I'm talking a lot of pain and discomfort and just weird hormonal imbalances that day. And you think about, you know, contraceptives, what they're doing is tricking your body into thinking that it's pregnant. So they trick your body into thinking that it's pregnant for 10 or 15 years. That can lead to some imbalances down the road. Do you guys think so? Yeah, so that's why that one's so scary. NuvaRing, that's the same type. Paxil, anti-anxiety. Propecia, Prozac, Risperdal, testosterone. So testosterone's one that those commercials are new, right? Because, you know, a few months ago, this wasn't linked to anything, but this is a newer one that it's linked to heart attacks. All testosterones, creams, injections, pills, all testosterone therapies increase the risk of heart attack. So we just had a patient recently, some of you heard this story, that got off his testosterone medication. He was told by two doctors that his testosterone was too low. We started getting him adjusted, and his testosterone raised to the point where they took him off the medication. So it's not just about the fact that he got off that medication, but it's about the fact that it's going to increase his risk of heart attacks as long as he stays on that. And he was told that he needed to be on it for the rest of his life. Topamax, Tylenol. There's a class action lawsuit against Tylenol. Viagra, Xarelto, Xolair, Yaz, Zofran, Zoloft, and that list is not all-inclusive. So we don't need to go into exactly what each of these medications does, but just by looking at this list, can we all agree that medications can be toxic? Yeah, they definitely can be. Now, here's the thing is that, you know, these are all prescription drugs, so a lot of times we think, well, yeah, I know that prescriptions are dangerous. I know I have to be careful with my prescriptions, but I could take Tylenol and ibuprofen and aspirin and take all those, you know, as much as I want. But the over-the-counters can be just as dangerous as well. Acetaminophen, Tylenol is the leading cause of acute liver failure. Ibuprofen is contributed to kidney failure. Over-the-counter cough and cold suppressants affect your brain chemistry long-term. Daily aspirin, a daily dose of aspirin, which has long been recommended, you know. But now, and it depends kind of on your doctor. I was reading something from an MD yesterday, and he said, it's been over a decade since I recommended people take a daily aspirin. But a lot of people are still getting those recommendations. But that can increase your risk of long-term, or increase the long-term risk of internal bleeding by up to 30%. Okay, so some of these things, even the over-the-counters that we've always been told are safe, are causing damage long-term. And if you think about it, you know, Tylenol or ibuprofen, what happens if I take the whole bottle at once? Where am I going? Hospital or dead, right? So what's it doing over time? It's doing the same thing. And I know that that's a stretch that, you know, it's not the same as, you know, a high dosage of toxicity, taking it all at once. But that's a good way to think about it, is what is it doing over time is the same thing that it does all at once, just spread out more over time. So that is the first one, though, is medication. So like I said, though, I'm not telling you not to go home and to dump out your medications. Don't do that. Talk to your doctor. Find out how you can get off of them, or find out how you can continue to address the cause. You know, a lot of you guys have been patients in our office long enough to hear some of our stories of patients who have gotten off of, you know, 15, 17, 10, 12 medications as their bodies continue to get healthier and healthier. But it wasn't like they walked in here one day, heard what we teach, and then the next day they walked in and dumped all their meds. It was a long, slow process, but they continued working on it, working on getting to the cause, working on their diet, their exercise, their spine, and the five essentials so that they could get off of those. Number two is tap water. Okay, and the reason that this is on here isn't because it's the most toxic necessarily, but it's because we're exposed to it all day long, right? My babies drink from bottles with tap water, and we use a filter, and they take baths, and there's certain things that are just unavoidable that we're being exposed to tap water a lot. You know, you can get things like whole home filtration systems. You can get filtered pitchers so you can pour from. You can get filters on your sink, but a lot of times you're still being exposed to quite a bit of tap water. And so there's a couple reasons why this is a concern. Number one is fluoride. Fluoride's been shown to decrease IQ in children, and it affects your cognitive function, it affects your brain. My dad's a dentist, okay? So you can imagine how we go at it about this one. But he's starting to come around. He says, okay, well, I'll admit that fluoride's toxic when you ingest it, but when we wash your teeth with it and you spit it out, then it's okay. And I said, okay, I'll meet you in the middle with that one. But yeah, if you're ingesting fluoride, it's a known toxin that that's been shown to lower IQ and affect your brain function, your brain development. So especially in kids, really dangerous. Chlorine is another one that, you know, and especially chlorine is a known carcinogen, but also when your shower, for example, like more so than drinking the water, when your shower steams up, that chlorine actually takes on two different forms, both of which have been shown to not only increase your risk of cancer and cause cancer, but oxidize cholesterol too, which that's what causes heart disease, is not eating cholesterol. If you guys even saw like the Time magazine cover last summer that said, eat butter. And then there's another Time magazine cover that says the cholesterol bunk demyth or something. There's, you know, all this research about cholesterol that eating egg yolks and eating animal products and eating high things that are high in cholesterol is not necessarily what raises your cholesterol. But then also even raising your cholesterol is not necessarily what causes heart attacks and heart disease. It's actually the oxidation of cholesterol. And so that cholesterol begins to break down. And that is what chlorine, or these two forms of chlorine in your steam, can lead to. Now, that's the thing, too, is to talk about showers, because a lot of times we'll say, well, I drink bottled water, or I have a filter on my sink, but we're not thinking about our showers. And when you're exposed to the shower, a couple things happen. Number one, everything steams up, so you're breathing it in, too. So you're getting it in through your lungs. You really, really have two ways to take things into your body, through your lungs or through your digestive tract. And the goal of both of those, the goal of, you know, the lung tissue and the digestive tract, is to let the good in and keep the bad out, right? But the chlorine can actually get in as you're breathing it in. The other thing that happens is your pores open up. Because even when you're in a hot shower, you're sweating. And that's a good thing. You know, we're going to talk about sweat as one of the main detox pathways. But sweat's your body's way of cooling itself down. So when you're in a hot shower, even though you don't feel it because you're already wet, you're sweating and your pores are opened up. And that water can seep in through those pores. They say that a 15-minute shower is the equivalent of drinking 8 cups of water. Okay, so that's your daily recommendation, is to drink 8 glasses of water, right? And we're going to change that recommendation a little bit. But so you're getting that, you're not getting the nutrition from it. It's not taking place of drinking water, but you're getting the toxic load of drinking 8 cups of unfiltered tap water. The next one is pharmaceutical drugs. So this is scary because we just went over that. And so you may think, well, you know, I don't take any drugs, so I'm good on number one. But if you drink tap water, you can be getting the breakdown products of some of these pharmaceutical drugs. And some of the scary things, some of the ones that they found in the highest concentrations, are things like your contraceptives, your hormones, right, your birth control pills, that not only in women but in men are going to alter their hormones. A lot of these toxins that we're going to talk about are hormone disruptors, and that's how they've been linked to cancer, is by disrupting your hormones. That's why so many of them are linked to breast cancer and hormone-specific cancers, because that's what they do. A lot of them are like synthesized or estrogen mimickers and different things like that that affect your estrogen-testosterone balance here. But yeah, you can get those in the pharmaceutical drugs in your water. They're really trace amounts, but still, they can find them in there, and if they can measure them in your water, then you're getting them. Right. Some of the other ones that they found in there are like anti-convulsant drugs, anti-seizure drugs. Those are some of the highest concentrations that you're getting in your tap water of pharmaceuticals. The next one are heavy metals. So lead, aluminum, other heavy metals. Why do you think you might get lead in your water? Pipes, right? Lead pipes. And they haven't used those for a while, but if you live in an older home, or even if your municipal water is using old lead pipes or even just lead joints, you're getting that in the water supply. And that can be tested, and you can find out whether or not you're high in these heavy metals, but you get those lead, aluminum, and other heavy metals from your water. Arsenic is another one. That's another metal, but it's also linked to cancer. Pretty heavily linked to cancer. And what they've actually shown is, what they've estimated at least, they estimate that about 56 million Americans are getting over the amount of arsenic that they need from their tap water. like far too much. 56 million Americans, so that's, it's not a majority, but it's a pretty big chunk of our population is getting a dangerous amount of arsenic from their tap water. And then the next one is pesticides that they've actually found. The USDA did this test. They found pesticides in 94% of drinking water. Okay, and so what, that's a concern. You know, if you're not familiar with what, you know, what pesticides can do and what they can lead to, start looking it up. But they share a direct correlation with autoimmune conditions on the rise, asthma and allergies on the rise from pesticides. There's also over 260 studies linking pesticides to cancers. So there's quite a few, you know, research articles out there on pesticides being linked to cancer, and you can get trace amounts of those from your tap water. Where's the other place you think you get amounts of pesticides? Vegetables, yeah, exactly, from your food supply. So we're going to talk about that in a minute, where those are coming from and, you know, what you need to do about it. But, yeah, a lot of times you might say, well, I eat non-GMO and I eat organic, but you're getting it from these other areas. And I was watching a show recently. It was one of those, like, real estate shows where they come in and they try to fix up their house or they try to buy them a new house. I don't know if you guys have seen these. But it was this family, and what got me into it was that they lived a similar lifestyle to me. They're very careful about what they put in their bodies and in their family's bodies. They lived a wellness lifestyle. They ate a lot of vegetables, and they're just really particular about their health. Well, then they come to find out they're doing an inspection of the home, and the whole home is lead pipes. And so they're taking all these measures to be healthier, but right under their noses, they never knew that they were getting the toxicity from an unknown source. So that's why toxicity is so dangerous, because it can come from so many different angles that you have to know how many faucets are on filling that bucket up. So that's number two, tap water. Number three, household products. This could literally be the whole night's workshop. I could spend the whole night on the household products, I could probably spend the whole night on them just off the top of my head. But cleaners, detergents, air fresheners, polishes, deodorant, shampoo, soaps, lotion, makeup, perfume. Okay, so this is a lot of our personal care products, but I grouped it in so that I could put it in the same category with some of these other things like the cleaners, because they're all household products. But one of the things that we're going to do, so you guys all have that handout there. It has a little bit of information on it, but it doesn't have near as much as I wanted to put on there. But there's, you know, there's a limited amount that we can put on there. But what we have is an email list that you guys can sign up, and we're going to send out some more information. So a couple of the things that we're going to send out, here's a couple of things, a non-toxic cleaning supplies guide. What this has on it, we'll send out the digital copy, but it says, you know, things to avoid, common items. It says avoid Clorox bleach. So that's bad. What's better is a brand like 7th Generation chlorine-free bleach. And so they give a couple non-toxic options that you could go out and buy at the store. And then it says what's best, distilled white vinegar. And it says you can add tea tree oil or Melaleuca oil or lavender oil for a clean, fresh fragrance too. But so we're going to give you some of the solutions to these, because we don't have enough time to talk about what the cleaning supplies are doing. But what I would encourage you to do is you can watch, you know, CNN videos of this. You can watch news videos where they'll go around and test the toxic burden of a home. And they'll be able to find that, you know, over here, it's high, it's measurable. But as they get closer to the cleaning supplies cabinet, the levels get higher and higher and higher before they're even in the cabinet. These are things that are floating in the air. They're called VOCs, or volatile organic compounds. Chelsea?
There's a book I read a few years ago, and it really stuck with me. That helped me transition to get toxins. That was called Green Goes With Everything. And she reiterates throughout the book that clean has no smell. And that's something that we get really addicted to, is, oh, my fabric softener, my laundry detergent, or the smell of bleach, like... Clean has no smell. So just getting used to that idea that clean really has no smell.
Yeah, and it's a hard thing to wrap your head around, because, you know, you just, like she said, you get so used to it. You know, I mean, what's going to look better, this or the unscented one next to it? You know, the lavender and peach blossom is going to sound a lot better. But yeah, that's something that you have to wrap your head around. A lot of these perfumes and fragrances are incredibly dangerous. They have what's called phthalates in them, and they're just incredibly dangerous, heavily linked to cancer, heavily linked to hormone disruption. So I'll go through a couple of these. Here's the other thing, though, that we're going to send out, and then we're going to send several things out, but this is another non-toxic cleaning guide, but this is a recipe book for make your own cleaning supplies. So when we're talking about toxicity and minimizing your exposures, some things, like, say, a medication, might take you a while to get off of, right? But some things you might be able to do tonight, right? So like a water filter, you're going to go home tonight and grab a water filter and you're done. Or the toxic stuff, you know, maybe you can get these recipes, make them this weekend, throw out your old stuff, and you're done, right? So some of these are quick fixes, but some of them are more long-term fixes. But this has, let's see what all we've got recipes for in here. A floor cleaner, a window cleaner, an air freshener spray, an all-purpose cleaner, a bathroom cleaner, a sink scrub, a wood polish, and a dresser and closet sachet. I've never heard of that. I don't know what that is. Have you heard of it? I've never heard. Yeah. So, whoever wants a sachet, we're going to send you a recipe how to make that. But here's the concern when we look through a lot of these is, you know, like, I'm going to go through a couple of examples. Like, deodorant, one of the biggest concerns with deodorant is one of the things we already looked at is this. One of the things that you're getting from your tap water, too, aluminum is found in your deodorant. Linked to neurological conditions like Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, dementia, things like that. So we want to get rid of aluminum, especially right in our armpit, which is an area where we sweat a lot. The pores open up. Things can get in there very easily, and our lymph system is right inside the armpit, too. So it's going to pick these toxins up right away, and then they're circulating through your body. Toothpaste. And I'm actually going to show you. Here's a picture of some of the things like that are laying around your house, probably. Lighter fluid, different paints. This is some kind of like polyurethane that you probably have, you know, maybe sitting in your basement that's been down there for 10 years and you don't ever think about it, but maybe that's where your grandkids play, right? So you have to think about, or, you know, I have a patient that she's had 3 or 4 dogs die of cancer. So I said, you need to look at what's going on inside your house. That's not a coincidence, because if it's happening to the dogs, what's happening to you? Something is going on in there. She has to find out what it is. Could be mold, could be a lot of different things. But with the household products, you know, we're going to send you some solutions for your cleaners, because that can be a quick fix. But here's the biggest concern are the personal care products. And we have done this workshop only on personal care products before, and we could talk about it the entire rest of the night, because it's crazy what's happening. I don't know if you guys can see these numbers, but this is the average number of chemicals in the different personal care products. So blush, average of 16 chemicals. Fake tan, average of 22 chemicals. Deodorant has an average of 15. Body lotion, an average of 32. Lipstick, 33. Eyeshadow, 26. Shampoo, 15. Okay, so there's a lot of different toxins that are in these. And what they've shown is when those all add up, women in general apply an average of 168 different chemicals a day. But teenagers were the ones that they found were doing it the most often. Teenagers applied 17 different products a day with an average of 174 different toxins or chemicals. So you can see how quickly the bucket's going to fill up. So that starts, say, maybe at 15 or 16. Then what it looks like is, you know, maybe it's at first painful cycles or irregular cycles. Then maybe in the 20s it's polycystic ovarian syndrome or something with the reproductive system. Then it's infertility. Then it's another condition. Then it's another condition. Then it's uterine fibroids. Then it's a hysterectomy. Then it's cancer. Right? So this isn't something that started. If you got cancer when you were 53, it didn't start when you were 52. It probably started when you were 2 or when you were 0, right? And it's been building this entire time. It did not start yesterday. These have been accumulating. So that's why this is such a concern. You know, they looked at 4 different chemical families, 4 of the toxic 12 that we'll send to you. What are the toxic 12 to look for in your personal care products? But 4 families, which are parabens, phthalates, triclosans, and musks, probably the four most dangerous. Triclosan, I'll just say, is anything antibacterial. So like something like this, any antibacterial wipe, triclosans are they're known carcinogens. So they found an average of 13 of those just from those four families. You know, they found, like we looked at earlier, they found over 200 chemicals in umbilical cords. So they found a lot more than 13 chemicals, but just from those four families, they found 13 different chemicals. So that's why this is scary. I'll read to you a couple of the other toxic top 12 other than parabens, phthalates, triclosans, and musks. Some of the other big ones are like sodium lauryl sulfate. So that would be on the back of like a shampoo. Anything that sudses, a soap, a shampoo, a toothpaste even. If you've ever used a natural toothpaste, it doesn't taste the same. It doesn't taste right. But it feels great afterward, but it doesn't suds the same. Or a natural shampoo or a natural soap a lot of times doesn't suds the same way that a Dial does or that, you know, a Vidal Sassoon does or whatever a name brand shampoo is. But here's a couple other ones. Sodium lauryl sulfate, triclosans, phthalates. Another one's propylene glycol. So that's something that is, so the EPA considers it so toxic that it requires gloves, clothing, and goggles to dispose of it by burying it. But it's something that they use in antifreeze. But it's in a lot of your personal care products. It's also in a lot of the food supply. Propylene glycol, you're eating it, a lot of it. Even color pigments. You know, color pigments are a big one that animal studies have shown that almost all color pigments in your makeup are toxic or carcinogenic, actually, cancer-causing. And a lot of those are the coal tar colorings, not from your mineral makeups or from your clean makeups. So one of the things that's on your handout there, because like I said, we could spend the entire night on this. One of the things that I would encourage you to do, two things actually that I'm going to encourage you to do. One is we have a YouTube channel that has a lot of videos on how you can stop filling your toxic bucket and how you can dump it out. Okay, so there's a video that goes into, you know, some of the personal care products that I use and how I choose them. There's a video that goes into, you know, what are the toxic top five? It's a little bit different than our top five because it was a couple years ago. But there's also, there's some videos that are going to show you how you can purchase these products or, you know, find a good brand that you trust. Because that's one thing you can do. You can find a good store that you trust. Like if you go to Real Foods Market or you go to Dave's Health and Nutrition, you're not going to find a bad product. At Sprouts, you can sometimes, at Whole Foods, you can sometimes, but you're pretty safe when you're at a healthy store like that. But there's also what you can do is find a brand that you trust. So like Dr. Bronner's is a great brand that we trust. You know, at times right now, I think we have a doTERRA soap in there, but we have Dr. Bronner's soap in the office. That's what I use at home. I use a Dr. Bronner's shave gel. I've used a Dr. Bronner's everything because I know that it's a brand that I trust. So when I look at that, I don't even have to flip the label over to make sure that it's safe because I trust the brand and I know that their quality of their standards are high enough that they're not going to put any of those things in. A couple others are like Tom's of Maine. You know, that one's hit or miss. It's incredibly better than most conventional products, but there's some things that they add in that are kind of gray areas. Like they have a fluoride toothpaste or they have a non-fluoride toothpaste. So it's your choice. So some of the times they're just answering consumer demands. But find a brand that you trust, too. But the other thing that's on your sheet there is there's a website, and it's called EWG.org. And that is the Environmental Working Group. And that's a group that's done a lot of these studies that we're talking about, the umbilical cord studies, the breast tissue studies. The Environmental Working Group has spearheaded a lot of these studies on toxicity. But what they've done with your personal care products is they've tested over 25,000 of them. So I could easily go on there and type this in and look it up. Or I could go on there and type in Aquanet and look it up. And we've done this with a lot of different products. And I'll tell you, to be honest with you, some of them I was pleasantly surprised with. Because you think, I thought a lot of the name brand makeups, you know, your Revlons, your Mary Kay's, or the bigger companies, I thought, man, these are going to be full of toxins. And they scored maybe a B or a B minus. You know, they score them and they score all the individual ingredients. And why are they a concern? Is it because it causes cancer or because it causes lung irritation or what is the concern? They score them all individually. And it's pretty cool to see. So if you've got something when you go home, again, I don't want to throw this away. I love this shampoo. I have to have it. Look it up. See how toxic it is. If it's something that you're willing to keep, maybe it got a B minus. That's not the best grade in the world, but it's a passing grade, right? So maybe you can change out some other things to A products and keep the one that you love. But ideally, we're going to change out all of them, right? Ideally, we're not going to have any B minus products. We're going to have all A plus products. But, you know, that we don't always live in an ideal world. So you can look up your products to see which ones you need to get rid of. Number four is heavy metals. Okay, so this includes metals like mercury, lead, aluminum, cadmium, arsenic, like we already talked about. And a lot of these, and if you look at it, if I read these off, think about what these all have in common, especially the first few until we get down to about thyroid disease. ADD, autism, autoimmune disorders, chronic fatigue syndrome, ALS, Alzheimer's, Parkinson's. The thing that stands out to me about all those when I was reading through those, they're all neurological. So that's how heavy metals can affect, is they can cross the blood-brain barrier and affect your brain and affect your ability to think and perform actions and come up with answers. And you get what's called a brain fog. And you guys all know that feeling of when you have brain fog. That's what these heavy metals can cause. And if you leave them there, they lead to increased problems down the road. So a couple others, you know, thyroid disease, MS, kidney disease, fibromyalgia, asthma, infertility, and insomnia. So you have to know where you're getting these heavy metals from so that you can limit your exposure. So that's the next big thing is, okay, that makes sense, but where am I getting them from? You know, we already talked about the lead pipes. You could be getting them from your pipes and from your water supply. And that's actually what this picture is a picture of a water pipe that has some floating mercury, floating cadmium, floating copper, arsenic, lead. Cadmium, what do you guys think of when you hear cadmium? Does anything come to mind? Even if you've never heard of it before, did you think of anything? Because what I thought was, yeah, I heard of batteries. Because even before I, you know, had ever taken a class and learned the elements or anything, that's what I thought of, nickel cadmium batteries. So that you can get it from those as well. But here's where you're going to get them from the most. This is the relative sources of exposure. So remember, we're limiting our exposure. So when you hear mercury, you hear a lot of talk about this one these days, right? About vaccines. Or you might even hear a lot of talk about, you know, tuna, or, you know, when you're pregnant, they don't want you to eat certain types of fish or seafood in general because the mercury is a concern. But here's where you're getting it from, and this is the most right here. And so once again, this is something that my dad and I go back and forth on because he's a dentist. He's put amalgam fillings in people's mouths for years. But now, you know, he's a maximized living patient. He lives a maximized living lifestyle. So now he's kind of coming around, but he still hates to admit it. Crystal, do you have a question?
Can you read those off
because
they can't be seen?
Oh, yeah, sure. Sorry. Can everybody see that now? Amalgams is the biggest one. So dental amalgams. Vaccines is the second highest. Then seafood, then industrial causes, then others. So with that, you know, one of the things is your body can clear about 0.4 micrograms of mercury a day. Okay, so 0.4 micrograms a day. But, and that, you know, that doesn't sound like anything, a lot or a little, if you don't know how big that is. But a can of tuna, one can of tuna, contains 25 micrograms. Okay, so that means that it takes approximately 62 and a half days to detox that one can of tuna. So that's why this is such a concern, is because these things accumulate. And that's why I said that when you look at overall exposures, this could be exposing you more than your tap water, because you don't drink tap water every second of every day, but that filling is in your mouth every second of every day. There's different things that you can look up as far as like when hot foods interact with amalgam fillings, there's more mercury released. When you chew your food and there's contact made with that filling, there's more mercury that is released. So there's a lot of things that you're doing that you're constantly just giving yourself a flow of mercury, hope, from your fillings.
Had several cavities, and we and six men got fillings, and then when I found this out, started thinking
about it.
We had to remove and replace, and he had always had red dots looking bumpy.
Yeah, from the back of his arm.
And I'd taken him to a dermatologist where we lived now. It was a Harvard medical dermatologist who lived in Cambridge. And they're like, oh, there's nothing you can do about it. You can get a steroid topical cream. And when we got those amalgams out, he thought on the ride home they went away. And I didn't believe it. But 2 days later, I really looked because he had a long sleeve shirt and he was like touching them because he had heard this. And 2 days later, they were
really, yeah. So that's first off an awesome story. And did you guys all hear that her son had a condition on his skin, and after his amalgams were removed, they noticed it went away right away. But here's the best part of that story is the part that we're never going to know: what happened if you left him. You know what I mean? That's the best part. Is where would he be when he's what is he now? Four? What is he?
14.
Oh, your other son. Okay. So yeah, where would he be when he's 25 or 35 or 45, you know, if you left those in. And a lot of us, you know, you don't have one. You got how many? You got a full mouthful a lot of times. Now, this is another thing like medications. I'm not saying go home and take out your amalgams or go to your dentist and just, or go home and get a screwdriver and pop them out. Bad idea. Very, 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 very bad idea. But there's a protocol for this. You know, first off, you can go to a dentist that knows a protocol for how to remove it safely. Because, you know, my dad, if you remove an amalgam, mercury is the second most toxic substance on the face of the earth, second to radioactive plutonium. One drop the size of a grain of rice will contaminate a 25,000-gallon pool. That's how toxic it is. It's incredibly toxic. And when you get rid of it, you know, it's got to be in a hazmat bag, but a toxic bag. Somebody's got to come and pick that up. It's incredibly dangerous. And that's the same thing, you know, if you I remember breaking a thermometer when I was a kid. My mom let us play with mercury on the floor, and it was really, really cool. But now looking back, it's like, it wasn't so cool. Even though it's cool to see how it like jumped around, that I'm not going to let my kids do that. But yeah, that's a great story, Hope. And yeah, you can get those removed. But yeah, there's a protocol that you can do for a few weeks before the removal and a few weeks after the removal. So you can email me if you want to know more about that, about what you can do about your amalgams to get those safely and effectively removed. And then make sure that as they're being removed, there's no side effects along with that. But this is where a lot of the exposure comes from. Another thing that I would encourage you guys to do, and first off, so I didn't mention this, I guess, but our podcast is on iTunes, and it's called Real Health with Dr. Taylor. So Real Health with Dr. Taylor. And one of the coolest episodes that's on there is actually an episode of my radio show where I interviewed a parent of a vaccine-injured child. And so this little girl is now 14, so, and she's been injured since she was 2. But so this parent has spent the last 12 years researching and finding out what caused it and doing heavy metal tests and doing every detox under the sun. And he's literally an expert in heavy metal detox. And you can hear him talk about how this affected his daughter. You can hear him talk about how much mercury is still in some certain vaccines through thimerosal, which is 49% mercury by weight, which is a preservative they put in vaccines. But he's an expert on it, and you can listen to him talk about it. And it's incredibly, incredibly interesting. What happened with his daughter was initially right away when she was born, she was given a hepatitis B vaccine, which if you don't know, that's one of the first vaccines that they give. And hepatitis B is a disease that's spread by intravenous drug use and unprotected sex. Right? So like my 2-day-old isn't having sex or doing drugs. Right? So this is a dumb vaccine in the first place. But then the baby, yeah, that's my opinion, obviously. But the baby then developed an autoimmune condition called vitiligo, which is Michael Jackson's disease. So where you lose pigmentation in your skin. So that was going on for the first 2 years. And so at that time, they knew nothing. So what do? They go to the medical lab. Like you said, you went to a Harvard-trained dermatologist that said, oh, we'll put this steroid on it. That's exactly what they did. So the first 2 years of life was steroids and antibiotics. Destroyed her immune system. Then she goes in for her normal round of vaccines, never speaks again, never is potty trained again, and has never, you know, lost their daughter. And some of you guys have seen our patients in our office that don't speak, that aren't potty trained. You know, they're 9, 10 years old. And yeah, that's scary, but that's what's out there. So you have to know about where you're getting it from there. Number 5 are your food additives. So toxins that you're getting from the food supply. And if you've been involved with our office for any amount of time, you've heard about this, right? Because we covered it in the 28-day challenge. We covered it through some of our past workshops. We're always covering it, but it's an easy solution. Eat real food, right? Eat clean food, eat real food, eat foods by God rather than foods by man that don't have any of these things added in. So here's the toxic top five, or my opinion, the toxic top five. One, artificial sweeteners. So that is things like aspartame. That's a known neurotoxin. You know, if you want more information on this, we've got a library of different books and things on all these. The one is called Sweet Deception, I think. But that's what it's talking about, is how, you know, the artificial sweetener industry has basically lied to us, because there are a lot of studies that show that artificial sweeteners are dangerous. But the argument would be that there are a lot of studies that show that artificial sweeteners are safe for us too. But who do you think funded those studies? The artificial sweetener companies, right? They got quite a bit of money. They can fund studies. Say, oh yeah, this is perfectly safe. We've got the research right here. That's a concern with all these things, is all the studies that have been shown to prove that these toxins or these food additives are dangerous have been independently funded. The ones that show that they're safe have been privately funded by industry. So artificial sweeteners, really bad. That's your NutraSweet, that's your Splenda, that's your, what's the other one, Equal. So the pink, blue, and red packages, get rid of those, or look, flip over your food supply, or food, and read your ingredients. Sometimes you'll be shocked to find out what all they've put these things in. And actually now, the artificial sweetener industry is really fighting hard, kind of like the GMO industry is, to keep their labeling secret. They don't want to have to let us know that it's in there, because they know that we don't want it, but they're trying to sneak it in there. But I also put up there sucralose instead of Splenda, because if you flip over your package, it's never going to say this has Splenda in it. It's going to say sucralose, which is the chemical name of Splenda. So that's what you want to look for when you're reading your food labels. You'll be shocked at how many things it's in. Gum, candy, some of the obvious ones. But it's in a lot of hidden things to just add flavor and make it a little bit sweeter. The next one is high fructose corn syrup. So the same thing, and we've talked about that quite a bit, that is concentrated sugar. So that is incredibly toxic, not only for heart disease, cancer, diabetes, inflammation, you know, all the list of the 21st century diseases that we're seeing so much of. But you want to avoid that. It's also, you know, there's a lot of research that says that high fructose corn syrup can be have trace amounts of mercury in it. So you can get heavy metal toxicity from some of these food additives. So you want to just eliminate them right from the beginning. The next one is MSG, or monosodium glutamate. Does anybody know what we think of typically when we hear MSG?
Chinese food.
Everybody, that was really good. I'm impressed. But yeah, Chinese food is what we typically think of. But it's in a lot of things. You know, one of the things that we'll include in the email is there's a list probably 10 or 15 names long of the aliases for MSG, what it can be hidden under. And when you see some of these aliases, you're like, man, I recognize that. I've seen that. It's all over your rice-a-ronis or your boxed and packaged foods. Almost every single thing that's going to have a powder flavoring in it is going to have MSG in it, which is a known neurotoxin. Number four is hydrogenated and partially hydrogenated oils. So that's trans fats. And a lot of us recognize that from the front of a box, because it'll say zero trans fats. So we've heard of trans fats, but what those actually are the hydrogenated oils. And that's what it's going to say on the back when you look at the ingredients. Hydrogenated or partially hydrogenated soybean or cottonseed oil, these different hydrogenated oils, that means that they're trans fats, incredibly toxic, damaged fats, bad fats. Remember, good fats help your body burn fat. Bad fats help your body store fat, so you want to get rid of those. Number five is preservatives. Things like, they'll be on your label as BHA, BHT, or things like nitrates and nitrites. That's one of the things that, like, some of our patients that have realized are a direct trigger to different symptoms that they're having. Nitrates and nitrites are heavily linked to cancer and heart disease. They're like when they put in meats that make them, give them a reddish color. So you want to look for your uncured meats, and look for meats even like at Sprouts. If you've been to one of our shops with the docs, we always point out the lunch meats that'll say very big on them, no nitrates and no nitrites. So you want to avoid all these things in your food supply. But really, you know, there's one principle that we talk about that makes this one an easy one. Eat foods by God, not foods by man. Eat foods that were made by a plant, not foods that were made in a plant. Right? So just look for foods that were grown the way that they were intended to, or the way that your great-great-grandparents would have eaten them. That's what you want to look for. Eat these good, healthy foods. We're also going to talk about in a second, the top five tips for detox. Guess what one of them is going to be? Same thing. Eat real food, right? Because that not only adds to your toxic bucket, but eating the right foods stimulates your body's detox the way that it's supposed to. So some others, that just didn't make the top five, like air pollution, like the inversion, and this year, this is only our third winter living here, but it seemed like this wasn't near as bad as the two before. But still, we all know that it can get pretty nasty out there. But what the EPA has estimated is that the air inside our homes can be 2 to 70 times more toxic than the outdoor air. So it's not necessarily always better inside than it is outside, even when there's a, inversion. So this is what we talked about earlier with pesticides. I guess we briefly mentioned that because it's in the tap water. But over 260 studies linking pesticides to cancer, over 60 studies linking pesticides to Parkinson's. So I wasn't surprised that pesticides were linked to to Parkinson's, but I didn't know that they had done this extensive of research or that there were this many studies proving it there. So there's a picture of air pollution here. There's a picture of, that's what the guy wears while he's spraying the pesticides. And then we just grab it with our hands and eat it. And then, warning pesticides, what's on my food? Another thing that I want to tell you just from a resource standpoint is that same website that we were talking about, EWG.org, those are the same people that put out the Dirty Dozen and the Clean 15. And have you guys heard of the Dirty Dozen and Clean 15? I know that some of us have. What that is, the Dirty Dozen are the 12 foods that have the highest load of pesticides when they test them. And then the Clean 15 is the opposite. They're the ones that have the lowest pesticide load. So the Dirty Dozen are the 12 foods that you should buy organic. The Clean 15, you don't necessarily have to buy organic if you choose not to. So like a big one for us is avocados. Avocados is number one on the Clean 15. It's got a really thick skin, so you're not eating a lot of the pesticides that are on there, and they don't spray a lot of pesticides on it. So an avocado, an organic avocado versus a conventional, about double the cost a lot of times. We get conventional avocados because they're relatively clean. Now, there are some other things that are on the Dirty Dozen that you want to watch out for, and you want to know what those are. A lot of them are like fruits and vegetables closer to the ground, because as the pesticides come down, they're going to catch all those. But you have to look at them and look to see what's dirty and what's clean. They also change that every year, so it's based on that year. So you can get on there and look at the 2015 Dirty Dozen, Clean 15. They also even have an app for your phone. So if you've been to a shop with a doc, sometimes I'll pull out my phone and just look at the app and talk about the app while we're walking around the grocery store doing the grocery store tour. So that's an easier way than memorizing it. Is to just look on your phone and look at the app. Or, I've had people cut out a piece of the picture of the Dirty Dozen Clean 15, keep it in their wallet or take it with them when they grocery shop. But you want to know where your sources are of these so that you can avoid them. So here is the second part of tonight, though, and what we really want to talk about. Because we talk about a lot, the problem. Right? We all now, even when we first came in, we all admitted and agreed that this was a problem and it was a growing problem. But we always want to point out the areas that are problems. But the biggest thing that we want to be in our office and in general is a solution. It's better to light one candle than to curse the darkness. Right? So what we want to do is offer people real life action steps and real life solutions on how you can detox your body. That's what the next half is going to go into, are the top five tips of what we can do every day to stimulate our body's natural detoxification. And that's the most important part, is that we're not inducing anything unnatural. We're just helping your body do what it's naturally designed to do. Your liver filters 2 quarts of blood every single minute. And on the first pass through a healthy liver, 99% of toxins are cleared that first time through. Now your liver has to break those down and do some things with them. So it doesn't mean they're cleared out of your body, But that's what your liver is designed for. That's what your kidneys are designed for. That's what your skin is designed for. We're designed to be healthy. And that's what we're always talking about, is how were we designed? How are our bodies designed to heal and function? And if we work with that design, you continue to be healthy or move in a healthier direction. But if you work against that design, you start moving the other direction. You continue to get sicker. So that's what we're going to talk about, is how we can kickstart our body's natural detox system. So there are three main detox pathways. These are all the different detox organs right here. So the skin, that's number one, sweat via the skin. You have really three main detox pathways, that through your sweat, through your urine, and through your feces. But there's a couple other organs that are involved with that. The lungs are another big one, because like we talked about, you know, the lungs and the intestines are the digestive tract. The job is to let the good in and keep the bad out. So if toxins are getting through our lungs, or if we have a leaky gut, like our last workshop was on gut health, or we have a leaky gut and it's letting toxins through, then that's a very, very bad thing, because those toxins are getting into our body. So those are barrier organs that help protect us. Then there are organs like the kidneys, the liver, that help actually detoxify, that help actually filter your blood, filter your urine, and put those toxins into your feces so that you can get rid of them. That's their job. So their job isn't to protect us by keeping the bad out and letting the good in. Their job is, once that bad gets in, because it's inevitable that some bad is going to get in, their job is to sift through that and get rid of it from there. So sweat through the skin, urine via the kidneys, and feces via the liver, the gallbladder, because what the gallbladder and the liver do is they produce bile that takes the toxins from the liver into the digestive tract, and then you get rid of them. So those are the three main detox pathways that we're going to be talking about and working with and stimulating. So a special focus, though, needs to go on the liver, because you know, the kidneys and skin are great detoxifiers, but your liver is your master detoxifier. Your liver is your most one of your most important organs. I say that now because it's a toxicity workshop, but then next time if we're talking about stress, I'll say your brain's your most important organ. But we also all know that the nervous system has to be number one. It has to be the most important thing, and the thing that we take care of before the heart, before the liver, before the kidneys, because that's what's controlling those things. But the liver, what the liver does is it detoxes fat-soluble toxins. So those are the things like the parabens, like the phthalates, the chemicals that we're talking about, and your body's going to, or the liver's going to take those, and it has two phases, okay? So this is important because we're going to talk about this a little bit later. It has two phases of detox, phase one and phase two. Phase one is when it takes those toxins and it does some reactions and it makes them more easily and readily broken down. So phase one is kind of preparing the toxin to be broken down and gotten rid of. Then phase two is actually where the toxin gets broken down, and then your body's able to get rid of. So phase one and phase two are both equally important. And there are the different things that you can have, like you can have phase two be sluggish and phase one be overactive. Then your body's just preparing a bunch of toxins to be broken down, but they never get broken down, so they stay in the liver. You start to get a toxic liver. So it's incredibly important to realize that there's two steps to detoxing in your liver. We're not going to go into the science and the anatomy of what all that does, but that's important to know, that there's two steps, and when one step isn't working properly, it can affect the other step, and vice versa. They can both affect each other, but that is the liver. A couple other things are, you know, some of the nutrients needed. We're going to talk about these in a minute. But nutrients, you know, like B vitamins. B vitamins are incredibly important for your first phase of detoxification, phase one. Another one's folic acid, which is a B vitamin. Glutathione as well, which is your body's master antioxidant and master detoxer. That's one of the things you might want to write down. We're gonna touch on it, a special focus on it in a minute. But that's one that, like, you know, if you've ever heard of toxicity, like watch Dr. Oz for it or something, he's always talking about glutathione. And I saw a Dr. Oz thing one time. We played it in a workshop where he's holding like a magnet above these metal balls, and it's going around and it's sucking up these metal balls. He said, this is glutathione and these are toxins. This is what it does in your body. It's your body's master detoxer and master antioxidant. And if you can't see that and how to spell it, there's a slide on it later. Another one is flavonoids. Those are from fruits and vegetables. Those are natural compounds that are in our live, raw, organic foods. The nutrients needed in phase two, a lot more of your amino acids, methionine, cysteine, glycine, those are amino acids. We're going to talk about those a little bit later too. So is choline, so is glutamine, so is taurine. So a lot of amino acids that are needed in phase two, but also the B vitamins. Once again, magnesium is a big one. That's a phase two detoxer. So we're going to talk about a lot of these in detail and how they help stimulate the liver doing its job. But so here's the top five everyday detox tips. And you guys have this on your handout sheet there. But number one is eat real food. That's a huge one, because then you're not only the real food helping your liver, helping your kidneys, helping your skin, just helping your body detox and dump the bucket, but then you're not filling the bucket as full. That's a huge one. And I think that it's, you know, I don't think that it's completely pointless, but the last thing that you want to do is, you know, put an effort into a detox or a cleanse or a supplement, or you're trying to clean your body while you're still detoxing it too. So if you're going to detox, make sure you're not retoxing. Eating clean food can help with that. So it's going to avoid the toxins, but also it's going to stimulate a lot of your detoxification, like we just looked at with the liver. So we're going to talk about that. Drink lots of clean water. That's number two. Exercise vigorously. That's the key word there, is vigorously. Rest and digest is number four. And number five is, when all else fails, supplement. So some of us are at the point where we need to be supplementing our detox to kickstart that thing into action. Okay, so how many everyday detox tips are we going to go through? Two people knew. Everybody say it at once. How many natural detox tips are we going to go through?
Five.
Everybody awake? It's going to be that time of night. I can feel it. I can feel it as well. It's getting to be that time of night. So we're coming on the home stretch, though. The things that you need to be doing, the action steps that you can take home and actually put into action tonight. So eat real food. So many foods help your body natural detox, especially a lot of veggies. So I'm going to go through some of these. So the first one is cruciferous vegetables. That is, or are, things like broccoli, Brussels sprouts, cauliflower, cabbage. So cruciferous means cross-like, and that's coming from the stalk. Like if you cut it and you looked at the stalk, it looks kind of cross-like on a lot of these. But these are the cruciferous vegetables. These are one of the only foods, if we go back, that stimulate phase one and phase two. These are massively important for detox. Probably the most important thing that we're talking about as far as foods go. So your broccoli, your cauliflower, your Brussels, and your cabbage, really, really important for detox. Now, one of the things with these, with this group of vegetables, what do you guys think? What's better with vegetables, raw or cooked?
Raw.
Raw. Good. Everybody knew that in unison. But with the cruciferous vegetables, it's actually been shown that slightly cooked or slightly steamed is a little bit better than raw. Okay, so that's one thing to know. You know, I like to eat a lot of raw vegetables, but with those, you know, a lot of times, we'll steam them even just lightly, makes them a little bit more absorbable and digestible without losing a lot of the nutritional value. So that's why you don't want to totally scorch them, but just a light steam can soften them up and make them a little bit more usable for your body. That one's huge. Anything green, though, and literally anything green is going to help your body detox. The thing that makes a food green is something called chlorophyll. I feel like, has anybody seen Billy Madison, where he said, chlorophyll, more like borophyll. I feel like I'm that teacher right now. Chlorophyll, more like borophyll. But yeah, anything green, spinach, kale, you know, lettuce, that's green beans, that's peas, that's literally anything green. That chlorophyll helps your body detox. They're also, your green leafy vegetables are the highest in nutrient density. So when you look at like phase one and phase two and the different nutrients that can help stimulate detox, these things are very nutrient dense. Your dark green leafy vegetables are some of the most nutrient dense foods on the planet. So lemon and lime, Joe.
Just a quick question. If you dry kale and like you're making kale chips or something, do you lose the nutrients?
I don't know. That's a good question. I'm sure that you do to some degree, and I'm sure it would depend on whether they're dried in like a dehydrator or in an oven. Yeah. I don't know. I've never read anything. But when you cook foods, you do lose some nutritional value. So I'm sure that you do. But yeah, it's still better. Kale chip better than a potato chip. But yeah, not as good as eating a leaf of kale. But that's not very good tasting. So. Lemon and lime, that's another one. So those can actually help stimulate your liver and help stimulate your detoxification. So those are some of the only, you know, fruits that we really encourage to help stimulate detox. A lot of the other fruits, you know, although fruits, you know, can be good for you, fruits are very high in sugar for the most part. Some things like berries and Granny Smith apples are a little bit lower on the glycemic index, which means they don't turn to sugars as quickly as your body and spike your blood sugar. So those are okay, and they're really high in antioxidants, which can help your body detox. But for the most part, for fruits, we stay away from them. But lemon and lime are completely okay when it comes to detox. Cucumber is another big one. So things like cucumber and chia seeds, it can be grouped together. And you would never think to put those two together in a group. But what they do is they're gelatinous. They turn into a gel-like substance. And you can kind of picture the inside of a cucumber, that it's kind of mushy and not as fibrous as the inside of, say, a carrot or celery or something. What cucumbers do in your digestive tract, in chia seeds as well, is turn into a gel-like substance that goes through your digestive tract and can clean it out. So those can be really, really good for detoxing. Onion and its family of foods like garlic are really, really, really good detoxers. And especially, you know, both of those two. But what do we do in our society is, you know, we get self-conscious about the way that our breath smells, or we limit, you know, how much garlic we're taking or how much onion we're taking because we're concerned about something else. But yeah, this is an awesome superfood that, you know, you look at it and you're like, an onion, that's the most plain food on the face of the earth. Now, that's a superfood. So you can take onion and often help stimulate your body's detox. Garlic, ginger, really, really good. What ginger can do is help your body, help stimulate bile production, which bile is the thing that's going to go past the liver from the gallbladder. And those toxins are going to go into that bile. Then all that's going to go into your digestive tract, and you're going to get rid of it. So that's one of the reasons why we want to be having, you know, regular bowel movements, because otherwise those toxins are sitting in there, and the longer they sit, the more likely they are to be reabsorbed. So with increased bile flow, with bile, it's just really important to have a diet high in fiber. So with these raw vegetables, with these raw foods, things like celery are great for fiber, because the more fiber you have in your body, the more that's going to pass through, bind with the bile and the toxins, and get rid of it as quickly as possible. Cilantro is another big one. Cilantro and parsley, huge ones that I want to touch on for a second. Cilantro actually binds heavy metals. Okay, so cilantro can bind mercury, can bind lead. Now, that means that if you have heavy metal toxicity and you've been tested, you know you have it, that doesn't mean that you can just, you know, go eat a cilantro salad and get rid of it, or take a few drops of, you know, cilantro oil and get rid of it. That's part of the process. But just, you know, if you're not concerned about heavy metal toxicity, cut up some cilantro and put it in some of your salads. You don't even hardly taste it, but if you do like the taste, it's really, really good. But a lot of times it's really easy to forget about. But it's something that you can add to a lot of your meals without making a very big difference, but it's going to help stimulate your detox. Parsley, too. Parsley can actually detoxify your bloodstream and actually detox your blood. So parsley is a really, really good detoxifier that you can just chop up and put it in a salad, put it in a smoothie, put it in almost anything and hardly notice it, but it's going to help. Another one is beets. Beets is just a good detoxer. So how can you take these? You know, you can take them raw. Raw's best, except for the cruciferous. For all the others, raw's best. Steamed, second best, or I'll go down, second best. Cooked is the last best. And then also when you're buying your foods, you know, it goes fresh, frozen, canned. Okay, so fresh is the best, but we can't always, you know, you don't always have everything fresh available. Frozen, second best. Canned is actually the worst. And while we're talking about toxicity, one of the reasons is cans are lined with BPA, which is a big one that, like, you know, plastic water bottles and things that have BPA, and now they have stickers on them that say BPA-free. Now there's other bisphenols, there's BPS, there's other ones that are in there too. But yeah, that's why why cans are bad. Romanza, did you have a question? That's exactly what I was just going to say, yeah. Because that's what made me think of it was, you know, how can you take these? So we posted on a picture on Instagram yesterday that after I spent all weekend focusing on this toxicity workshop, and so yesterday I was like, I've got to eat these things, right? Because after you look at this forever, it's like, I would feel really dumb if I wasn't doing these. And I do these all on a regular basis. But yesterday I had to make a big juice. So I made a big juice with celery, bok choy, ginger, lemon. What else is on there? Apple, yeah, Granny Smith, because otherwise it would have tasted nasty. So just add those in for some flavor. But yeah, so that's juicing is a great, great way. We're also going to talk about that with the next one too, or maybe it's two after this, but rest and digest. Because juicing is a great way, I'll just touch on it now, to give your digestive system a break. Because that's where the benefit of juicing is that it's a nutrient express right into your bloodstream. Your body doesn't have to break down any fiber. It doesn't have to break down any food. It's just absorbing the nutrients right away. So it can give your digestive system a break. That's also why it's good to have a higher quality juice or juicer, because you don't get as much fiber in with it. But yeah, juicing is a great way to get these in. Also, because the amount of stuff that I juiced yesterday, it would have taken me all weekend to eat it all, and I probably... I wouldn't have been happy by the end, but you can get it all, you know, in one juice, you can get quite a bit of nutrient density and a lot of nutrition from that. So that's an awesome, awesome thing that if you're not familiar with or you don't juice, you know, you can get a juicer, but really, it's hard. You know, it's not easy. It's not impossible by any means. It's totally doable, but it's not easy. You can also, there's a lot of good juice companies here in Salt Lake. We partner with Vive Juicery. There's also Blue Star Juice Company. There's a lot of different juice companies. They do delivery. They do 3-day, 5-day cleanses, beginner, intermediate, expert cleanses, all these different things and different options. So that's something just to kind of look into. Number three, we're skipping number two because we already talked a little bit about drink clean water and how we want to get a filter. So that is something that I would encourage everybody to do is get a filter. You can get... You know, the pitchers that you fill up and keep in your fridge, you can get one on your sink, you can get one on your shower. The shower one is really, really important. We have a shower filter, we have a sink filter. But we also have, you know, we have a shower filter, we have a sink filter, but we've got 4 sinks in our house. We only have 1 sink filter. So not everything is filtered, but it's a big difference compared to non-filtered. So by no means is anybody perfect, and we're far from it. But you do the best that you can when it comes to drinking a lot of clean water. But the one thing I do want to mention with that is how much water you should be drinking. Because the typical recommendation for everybody is 8 ounces or eight cups a day, right? So 64 ounces a day. But that's not the, you know, for you, Chad, it's not going to be the same for me and for you, Kelly, and for you, Joan. We're not all going to need the same amount of water. So I want to give you guys a rule of thumb. Half your body weight in ounces. Okay, so half your body weight in ounces. So I weigh about 160 pounds, so I need to drink 80 ounces a day. Okay, and so you might be a little bit above or a little bit below that. You know, if you weigh in the 400 pounds, you're not going to drink 200 ounces of water a day. I just don't know that you'd be able to do it. So to some degree, you know, this rule doesn't exactly apply. But for 90% of the population, half your body weight in ounces. So for me, this is 34 ounces. So I try to drink one of these in the morning shift. Then I go home and I fill it at home because we don't have a filter here. So I drink another one in the afternoon shift. And then I'm at about 70. And then when I get home at the end of the night, I fill it up again and, you know, drink another 10, 20, or maybe a whole another one, or sometimes I'll drink a whole one. If I'm at the gym, you know, if you're exercising or when it's hot out like this, if you're sweating, you're going to need more, right? But for the most part, half your body weight in ounces, really, really good rule of thumb. But number three is exercise vigorously. So not only does exercise make you sweat and you detox through your sweat, but probably the biggest thing that it does for detox compared to like a sauna, or, you know, just going out in the heat, the biggest thing that it does is it moves your muscles. And when your muscles contract, it stimulates movement of your lymph system. And your lymph system is part of your detox mechanisms and part of your immune system in a big, big way. So when you're stagnant, and that's why I picked this picture, my wife is like, why'd you pick that picture of that lady on a trampoline? Because it doesn't look like vigorous exercise. She's just like having fun. But that's called a rebounder. Has anybody heard of a rebounder or seen one of those before? You can bounce on a trampoline. Another thing that does it is whole body vibration. So how do you stand on the vibe plates after your adjustments? That stimulates lymph movement. Muscular contractions stimulate lymph movement. So that's things like even walking, any movement stimulates lymph movement. But exercising vigorously, you're going to kill two birds with one stone because you're also going to sweat. There's a lot of other things, benefits that you're getting from exercise. It's by far the most researched health intervention in history. And there's literally nothing that it doesn't help with. So you're getting a lot of other benefits. But from a toxicity standpoint, it's going to get your lymph moving and it's going to get you sweating. Okay, so sweating is really, really important. But most of us, how often do we sweat? We try to keep it at zero, right? Like if we sweat, it's like, oh my gosh, get me inside. I'm going to melt out here. But you need to be sweating at least a few times a week. At the very least, you definitely want to be sweating. So one of the things that you can do, or that a lot of people do if toxicity is a concern, you can get saunas, infrared saunas, or the old school saunas. I don't know what they're called, but infrared is the best way for detox. But the other thing, I mean, don't skip out on the exercise. Nobody should not be sweating at least a few times a week and getting their exercise in. Number four, rest and digest. Okay, this one is very, very important. So there's three action steps here, three things to kind of think about, but I'm going to go into a little bit more detail on what that actually means to rest and digest. So number one, minimize your stress, minimize your stress levels. That is, when your body is stressed, it takes all your blood flow away from the things that keep you alive, or that, like your liver, like your digestion, like your autonomic functions, all those things. It takes them away from those organs and takes it out to your muscles. It does things like raises your cholesterol, raises your heart rate, raises your blood pressure. Because the stress is, you've heard of the fight or flight response, it's preparing your body to move, preparing your body to either have a fight or to take off and have a flight. So you're ready to move. All your blood flows out to your muscles, slows down your digestion, slows down things like detox when you're constantly and chronically stressed. So you got to minimize your stress. You got to get adequate sleep. That's another thing where your body, the only thing that speeds up during sleep is your nervous system. That's when your body's going to do a lot of its detoxing, a lot of its maintenance work is while you're sleeping. So you've got to get adequate sleep. And you've got to check your gut health. So when we talk about rest and digest, like we said, Romanza, with juicing, that's where I was going to talk about. That was by giving your digestive system a rest and giving it a breather. Another thing you can do that we've mentioned before is like intermittent fasting or fasting in general. Now you can do fasting for a long time. You can do fasting for a short time. Or intermittent fasting is every day you fast and you only eat during an 8-hour window. So you might eat all your calories from 10 a.m. in the morning till 6 o'clock at night. That's called intermittent fasting. The rest of the time, your body's allowed to do this, to rest and digest. So with the digestive system, you know, one thing you can do is you can go back to our podcast channel again and listen to our gut health workshop. That was the last workshop that we had here, and it's available on the podcast. But, you know, a couple questions, you know, you're going a couple times a day. You know, that's at least once a day. You know, a lot of people will think, well, I'm not constipated. I go every other day. But no, that is constipation, and that's the number one risk factor for colon cancer. Do you have any cramping, bloating, or any other symptoms? Your digestive system is incredibly important. And, you know, if you just think about it, the job of the digestive tract, let the good in, keep the bad out, and then get the bad out, right? So you don't want that sitting in you. You want that getting out as quickly as possible. Make sure that those toxins are getting out. Here's the other one is, you know, just with the rest and digest and the stress. I'm not going to go into this in too much detail, but this is the fight or flight. So this guy has chosen to flight. He's running away from that snake, right? And when your fight or flight system is dominant, then your parasympathetic or your autonomic functions or your detoxing, your digestion, your things like that, those are going to be decreased. So that's why when you're in your sympathetic dominance or you're in a stress state all the time, all these things are turned off and down-regulated. So you have to look at stress. That's actually going to be the next workshop that we're going to have is going to be on stress and the implications of stress and what it leads to from a physiological standpoint, not just from a mental breakdown type of standpoint. And the last one, supplements. So I'll go over a couple of these supplements, what they can do, and where you can get them, things like that. Antioxidants is one. Hope.
Just before you read the last one, what importance do you guys place on supplements and supplementation and regularity of meals? Obviously, there are a lot of ways that you said fasting that, but meal times and sleep times.
Sleep time is incredibly important. I'd say both incredibly important. When your body gets into rhythm and rituals, really, really important that you have set times when your body, when you're used to eating, and especially sleep. That's really important with sleep, that, set sleep time and set wake time. Yeah, really important, Lonnie.
I read an article once that said that our bodies actually sleep the deepest between 10 o'clock and 2 o'clock. And that you get double the amount of sleep if you sleep during that time.
Yeah, I have heard similarly that even though you might be getting 8 hours, but if you go to sleep after midnight chronically, you're not getting nearly as restful, of sleep. So that's definitely something to look at is, if you have sleep concerns and not just go, even if it's natural, don't just go take a melatonin or take something that helps you sleep. Look for the cause. And one of the causes might be just bad cycles. Get yourself in a rhythm. There's other things that you can do, you want your room to be really dark. Melatonin is the darkness hormone. When the lights go down, when the sun goes down, when the lights in your room go down, that's when your body starts to naturally produce melatonin. Another one is sleep in the cold. That's better to sleep in the cold. You're more likely to be induced into sleep. You can even take a hot shower and then go into the cold because of a sharp temperature change like that will make your body tired too. So there are natural ways to work on your sleep. Rather than just taking a sleeping pill, which are incredibly dangerous, incredibly scary, or even something like a melatonin that's natural. But supplements, so that's where melatonin would fall in. Antioxidants are huge. All antioxidants help stimulate detoxification. So these are a couple of the vitamins. They call them ACEs and zinc. Vitamins A, C, E, and selenium are the vitamins that are the big antioxidants. Selenium is a mineral, and zinc. Selenium it will competitively bind with the sites for mercury and lead. So say you're getting your amalgams taken out, and you're going to have some mercury circulating through your body. Selenium is one of the things that might be part of a protocol because it binds to the sites where lead or mercury go. So that's like you go to your home and you try to put your key in the hole, and somebody's filled that hole with super glue, can't get in. So mercury and lead can't get in if they've got, key to your home. Good defense. Milk thistle is a very important herb that is good for liver detox. So is dandelion root. Dandelion root actually stimulates bile production as well, stimulates bile production in the gallbladder. Chlorella is a huge one that can help detox. Chlorella, spirulina is another one that's found in that category. These things come from the seaweed and algae families, like spirulina, that can help your body detoxify. Glycine is another one. That's right here. That's an amino acid. That's one of the building blocks of glutathione and one of the incredibly important amino acids that's required for your liver and for your detox. I'm going to show you in a second here some of my lab testing that I did that showed that I needed to supplement with glycine that I would have never known. Free-form amino acids, that's just another version of amino acids right here. Great for the liver because we looked at how those amino acids are necessary for that detox. N-acetylcysteine, that is an amino acid. Glutathione and activated charcoal. So I'm going to talk about just the last two is glutathione, we're going to talk about it in a sec, but activated charcoal can actually bind toxins and take them out. That's what they give you if you go to the hospital and you've OD'd or you have alcohol poisoning or something. They're going to pump you full of activated charcoal. You're going to puke it up with all the toxins with it. What, Dennis? Black. Like Ipecac. So the other one, though, special focus is glutathione. So this is your body's master detoxer and master antioxidant. It's made of cysteine, glycine, and glutamine. And that's not necessarily important to you guys what it's made of, but when you're getting the building blocks, like one of the things, whey protein, like our grass-fed whey protein, has been clinically shown to boost glutathione because it gives the building blocks. You don't get glutathione in the protein, but you get the building blocks, then your body's able to make it. The secret are the sulfur groups. That's also what's really, really good about the cruciferous vegetables, the things like onion and garlic. The same thing as sulfur. Sulfur is kind of sticky, and it can bind to toxins and get rid of them. And it aids both phase one and phase two of detoxification. Glutathione is incredibly, incredibly important that you have adequate levels. You can see there that it just says it's produced naturally within the body, and it's present in every single cell. So this one's really important. Now, one of the things I want to mention is if you go to the supplement store tonight on your way home, you might see glutathione, but don't get it. The research is very, very unclear as to whether or not you can even absorb it. So that's why the building blocks are so important, that you're getting these building blocks. You get them naturally from food, but then if your body is too toxic, you're going to deplete all your glutathione, and you're not going to be able to clear those toxins out. So you have to be providing your body with the building blocks there. That is also one of the most important parts of our detox system. So will you throw me one of those, Ashley? The detox system, and this is another important part that I just want to touch on, because there's a lot of supplements, and a lot of you guys know if there's a supplement that we don't sell, we'll tell you where to go get it. We'll tell you that where the best option is. This is the best detoxing supplement that I've ever seen. And we have people that come in here that aren't patients, that have just read about it and heard about it, and they want to get it. They call in. It's hard for us to keep this on the shelves because it's really popular, because it's the best detoxer out there. It's a two-part detox system. That's why it's called detox system. The first part is cell detox, which takes toxins out of your cells, takes them to the liver. The second part is called body detox. The body detox takes them from the liver and excretes them. So when we're looking at, you know, some of these supplements, you could go out and go to the store and find a few of these and take some, but you're kind of shooting in the dark. What these have are a lot of the ones that we're talking about: magnesium, milk thistle, psyllium husk, peppermint leaf, fennel seed, ginger root, activated charcoal. So really, really potent and powerful detoxifier. If you want to know more about this, we're running out of time. If you want to know more about this, ask us at the end. All of our supplements, unless you heard us on the radio, all of our supplements are 10% off tonight. So if you want a detox system, we've got a couple left on the shelf over there. But that is a really, really good one. And, you know, what to do when that's not enough. Because a lot of times, you know, we can do these things if we are relatively toxic. But a lot of times, if we've got a chronic disease, if we've got a diagnosed condition that we're trying to reverse, you might want to know more specifically what your toxins are, so that you can know what you're going after. And the only way to know for sure is by getting tested. You can test the blood, you can test the urine, you can test the feces, you can test for different things like, you know, the inorganic phosphates, you can test for volatile organic compounds, you can test for parabens, for phthalates, for BPA. We do a lot of those testings here. Heavy metal testing, we haven't gotten into yet. That's a lot of times through fecal tests. But test to know what's going on. That's the only way to know. And, you know, what can be measured can be improved. So I was shocked when I was high in xylenes. I'd taught toxicity for a while. I didn't know what xylenes were. I had to look it up. They come from like glues in carpets and glues in beddings. They come from exhaust. So that's one that I tested high and that I was shocked at. And so I needed glycine, was what was recommended to kickstart that liver detox that actually can bind to these xylenes and get rid of them. But the maximized metabolics testing that we do in the office tests six different biomarkers for toxicants and detox indicators. So that's six. It tests overall, I believe it's 52 or 54 different biomarkers that it tests in the areas of inflammation, of toxicity, of gut stress, of neurotransmitter balance. And what it is it's not just testing to tell you, hey, here's this problem, figure out what to do with it. The whole point of it is it's customized supplementation. So a lot of people, you're already taking supplements, but you don't know exactly if it's what you need. You just heard it on Dr. Oz, or you read it in Prevention Night, or, you know, along the way, you picked up these little things about this is good for that, this is good for that. And before you know it, your supplement cabinet has 10 or 20 different things in it, but you never know exactly what you really need. This measures your blood and urine and tests and tells you exactly which supplements you should be on, which pathways are broken there. So
that's the other thing, that if they're on something, but they have so many toxins that they're not digesting it.
Yeah, that's the worst, is if you're taking it and you're not absorbing it. And that's the problem, too, with a lot of supplements, like, you know, just say your traditional, your Costco supplements, a lot of your GNC supplements, some of your lower quality supplements, Walmart supplements, you're not digesting and absorbing them the way that you think you are. So, yeah, that's a big thing, is to be able to test it and find that out. But I want to show you this. This is 5 out of the 6 indicators that it tests for. And I'll show you, excuse me, Chad. This is mine on the left here. So I was high over here in toxicity up here. This biomarker is called 2-methylhippurate, but it indicates exposure to xylenes. But I was also high down here in glucarate, which indicates exposure to toxins like drugs, pesticides, herbicides, fungicides, petrochemicals, alcohol, or toxins produced in the GI tract. That was a massive, massive concern to me. And a lot of you guys know I do a detox system quarterly at the very, very least, almost all the time. And I always tell people about what I notice every single time, energy. I sleep like a rock and I wake up wide awake. I do not need an alarm clock when I'm taking the detox system. Then there's my mom's. So she was toxic in 2 different ones, or she was high in one and low in another one, but a little bit different. The same one here, glucarate, the drugs, pesticides, herbicides, fungicides, petrochemicals, but then also, which petrochemicals, that's like pharmaceuticals. Then this one, pyroglutamate, indicates glutathione wasting due to increased production. So she has some glutathione issues that we had to work on due to increased glutathione production. It was starting to waste away, so we had to look at that. But that's one of the things that you can do, is get that tested. The last thing that we want to talk about is, as always, we want to tie it all together. Looking at, you know, I don't want you guys to walk out of here and be like, man, I need Nook Thistle, or I need detox, or I need detox system even, you know? You have Nook Thistle growing in your backyard? Bring it in. Bring it in. Man, we're getting hooked up from our patients. We're getting cilantro and parsley and we'll get Nook Thistle. We're going to make our own detox system from our patients' gardens. It's a local detox. But, you know, we're going to tie it back together to looking at the way that the body was designed. And when you look at the way that the body was designed, you see that there's one thing that controls everything else. And so when you're looking at what controls detox, it's the nervous system. And this is what we looked at before. I chose this picture because, you know, with the parasympathetic and sympathetic dominance, this is your parasympathetic side over here. So that's rest and digest. That's why, you know, we've talked about, like, at the gut health workshop, a good thing is you can take 9 deep diaphragmatic breaths before you eat, and you'll go into parasympathetic dominance, deep breathing, yoga, prayer, meditation. All these things can kickstart your body into parasympathetic dominance, which is where stimulates gallbladder, stimulates digestive activity, and it stimulates the autonomic functions, whereas the sympathetic, which is more your stress, is going to stimulate glucose release by the liver, is going to take blood, shunt blood away. It's going to increase your blood pressure, increase your heart rate, increase your cholesterol from being too stressed. So you're parasympathetic and sympathetic. But the nervous system right here, the spine and the nervous system, is what controls everything, every aspect of your health, every function in your body, and everything that has to do with toxicity. It comes from the nervous system. And this is exactly how this works. This is the spinal cord right here. And, you know, we draw that picture of a line going from here out to the heart and things. It's incredibly complicated and complex. This is a little more realistic of where those nerves come to, from the spinal cord out to the adrenal glands, out to the viscera, which is your liver, your intestines, your autonomic functions that are happening without you thinking about it. That is what controls them. So when there's interference to the spine, interference to the nervous system, or subluxation, where the spine has shifted out of alignment, and it's putting pressure on these nerves and affecting those messages as they go out to this rami and then go down to the viscera, how well do you think you're going to be detoxifying? That's like having an air purifier at home and never plugging it in, right? Because it's never plugged in, it's never working. Same thing with your liver, same thing with your intestines, same thing with your kidneys. How many of you have ever known anybody to have kidney disease? Maybe a couple people. They have it in one, or do they have it in both? you should have it in one, right? So what's the difference between their left kidney and their right kidney? Did their left kidney filter all their toxins and their right didn't? No, they'll have nerve interference going to one of the kidneys in their lower back where those nerves go out to control those organs. So they've actually measured this. This is the last thing we'll wrap up with this study right here, that they've actually measured this. This is a group of compounds called thiols. So glutathione, for example, is a thiol. It's a larger group of things, but glutathione is one of the thiols. And it is an indication of DNA repair. Okay, so it's your body's master antioxidant, but it also repairs your DNA. So what they did is they measured serum thiol levels in patients with active disease, in wellness, or just, you know, people without active disease that weren't getting chiropractic. And then they measured it in the chiropractic patients too. And what they showed, the results right here, there were statistically significant differences in the thiol levels of the three groups. Down here was active disease. Right here was wellness or non-chiropractic patients. But the chiropractic patients, their serum thiols were higher than both groups. And if you look at some of the things like, you know, the poster over there that showed that patients who have gone under long-term chiropractic care have, what is it, 65% fewer pharmaceutical costs, 60% fewer hospital admissions, spent one-third of the money. That's one of the reasons why. Every single time you get adjusted, it's not just relieving neck pain, relieving back pain, relieving headaches. It's activating your nervous system and allowing your body to detox and do all the things that it's supposed to do and that it was designed to do. So that's why we get the spine adjusted, why we start there and work our way out, because that's the way the body was designed. So that is it, you guys. Thank you, everybody, for coming out. Tonight's workshop will be on the podcast channel, but go and look it up. You can either go to realhealthwithdrtaylor.com. You can Google it. You can find it. You can go to iTunes and type in Real Health with Dr. Taylor. You can find it anyway by just typing that in. But tonight's workshop will be on there in about a week or a week and a half. But there's a lot of other things, a lot of other good resources. So get on there and start listening to those if you want to learn more. You can also always send us an email, ask us if you want to know more about anything that we talked about. But otherwise, thanks everybody for coming out. Hope you learned something. But more importantly, I hope you use something.
Thank you for listening to the Real Health Podcast with Dr. Taylor Crick. This episode has been sponsored by realhealthresource.com, your go-to resource for everything health, nutrition, and wellness. Be sure to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter and Instagram, and of course, please visit our website at realhealthresource.com.